So you've got yourself a BMW B48 engine. Now, they don't just come in BMWs. You may well have that in a Mini. It might even be in a Supra. But the B48 is a fantastic engine. There's a lot of tuning parts, a lot of upgrade potential with it. So this video is just going to be a very quick overview on the best mods and upgrades for your BMW B48 engine. It's going to be based very much on our members' feedback from our forum and feedback that I've had on articles that have been put up on our website and also from comments made on this channel and from people that I've spoken to at car shows with the B48 engine. I am planning a much more detailed series of articles on the B48, so please subscribe to make sure you don't miss out on that. And please let me know in the comments what your thoughts are, which mods you feel are most effective on the B48. And if you feel some of the points that I've made in this video are not correct or you've got something to add, please shout up in the comments. This is very much a community-driven, collaborative effort, so I really do welcome your feedback and comments, because it helps us all to gain a deeper understanding of this fantastic engine. So the B48 is a successor to the very popular N20 BMW engine. The engine comes with VANOS, a double VANOS system, which alters the intake and the exhaust timing durations on the valves using a very clever hydraulic system, which dramatically improves the power and the fuel economy of the engine. So typically these engines are at a 2-litre capacity, so a bit smaller than their big brother, the B58, which was a 6-cylinder, 3-litre engine. But these 2-litre B48s can offer a decent amount of power. There was also a 1600cc model, and although most of them did come with a twin scroll turbocharger, there were some supercharged variants out there. So the approach for tuning all of these engines is very, very similar, but we're going to detail really specific mods for the B48, but we're going to be rather general in our approach to this. The fact that Toyota chose the B48 to put into a car like the Toyota Supra goes some way to show how much confidence Toyota have in the BMW engineering behind this great engine. So it may not have the headline power figure of its 3-litre 6-cylinder brother, but it produces a decent spread of power in all the different guises it comes in. Power range from about 154 to over 300 horsepower, and it's a great, well-designed, under-square engine block. The four cylinders are nicely set up. There's a clever low friction, low heat transfer coating on the cylinders themselves, which further aid the reliability of the car. So compared to the N20, they used a closed deck block, and this engine has a longer stroke. So it offers greater engine efficiency, so you get more power for the fuel that you're burning in this engine. So there's a lot of different engines in this group, a lot of different power figures, and significant differences really are just down to the electronics used in the engine. There's a few significant differences at the upper power levels, so they tend to come with stronger rods and cranks, a stronger piston, and those 300 horsepower engines also had a slightly lower compression ratio, which allows them to turn up the boost and just make that little bit more power from them. So the brain of your BMW B48 is the DME, the digital motor electronic unit, and that's really controlling everything in the engine. So by changing that, you can make substantial gains to your power. So what are your options? Well, there's lots of different products and options out there when it comes to tuning these engines, but the two popular ones that we're going to talk about today are the boot mod 3, or the boot mode, which is the correct name, but most people refer to it as the boot mod 3 or also the BM3. And we've got the Berger tuning, or the Berger Motorsports JB4. So the two units do quite a lot to enhance the power of your car, but they're suitable for very different people with very different aspirations. So first we'll talk about the boot mode, or boot mod 3 if you want. This is effectively a complete remap or a complete tune. You can change all of the parameters in the engine. So you will connect your computer to the diagnostic port on the car. You will download flash tunes or flash maps and upload them to the car. So you can do a lot with these, but it's a lot more complex. The nice thing that this has is data logging, so you can actually see what's going on in the engine, and you can use that information to just extract more power to see where the flat spots are or where the weak areas are in the tune. So these are suitable for people that are wanting more adventurous power gains, those people that have done lots of extra mods to their car and just want to get the maximum power from it. It's also helpful if you want to switch to a different ethanol content fuel. You can make adjustments within that for this. But it's more expensive. It's requiring a bit more specialist knowledge, and there's a bit more scope for things to go wrong if you push things too aggressively. The JB4, however, is effectively a piggyback unit. It plugs into your car through the diagnostic port, the OBD2 port, but it also has connections to various sensors inside the engine. So it's very simple to set up and plug in. It typically takes about 30 minutes. You just need a screwdriver and some basic skills. If you can unplug and plug in a cable, you can pretty much fit one of these quite easily. And this effectively has off-the-shelf tune options for your car. There's quite a lot of different options available within the unit. And it can also, if you get the module, connect it to your mobile phone through Bluetooth, pretty much as you're ready to drive the car and you get into it. So this is a very low hassle approach. It's low risk. It costs less money. So this is probably the option for most people that just have the standard mods that everyone else is doing, the induction kit, the exhaust mods, the basic set of power upgrades that you might add to your B48. But if you're going for more adventurous mods, then this probably isn't the device for you. Although it is quite flexible, you can achieve a lot with that. But there's lots of other devices out there that do similar things to these two. So please let me know in the comments what your experiences have been with these. I've seen projects with aftermarket ECUs. One used, I think it was the Mega Squirt ECU. So that was a fairly complex project. It wasn't really a B48. They'd done a lot of other mods to it and they were making significant power gains. But certainly the aftermarket route is where you would want to be if you've made substantial gains or you've changed the engine significantly or the turbocharger and you're making substantially more power than the factory originally intended. The throttle controller in these drive-by-wire engines, you can really sharpen up the throttle response with some kind of boost controller. So a lot of people have mentioned the Sprint Booster. Let me know what your thoughts are on that particular brand, whether it's worked for you, whether there's other brands that people should be looking at as well. But effectively, that just quickens the throttle response. So as you put your foot down, you get a much better, faster, more aggressive response from the engine, which is subtle, but it does transform the way the B48 delivers power. So in terms of cost and the benefits you'll get as a driver, they're certainly worth considering, and they're up there with the DME tuning options. So is it worth changing the cam on a B48? Well, not really. You've got Vanos. So altering the Vanos profile will really do the same job as a performance cam. So it's not really a mod or an upgrade for most drivers. They're very, very complex when you start getting into cams and profiles on these engines. So just stick with the electronic adjustment, the ECU maps, the tunes that you would drop into the ECU. So it's been noted that on some models at higher RPMs, the valve springs on the B48 are lackluster. They're underpowered or under strength. They're a little too weak, really. So uprating those springs can really help you to sit in those higher RPM ranges without having the problem of valve float, which can cause all sorts of other running problems. So we found Kelford offer a decent set of springs for the B48 engine. The seat pressure is about 90 pounds at about 11 millimeters of lift. People often talk about turbo upgrades on the B48 engine. So this is certainly a significant power adder, but you need to be very careful choosing turbos. We found that a lot of the cheap budget turbo upgrades don't tend to work very well. They tend to break quite soon on a lot of projects. Often that's down to neglect or just pushing the turbo further than the manufacturer intended. But those budget cheap turbos are not really worth your investment if you want to make aggressive power. If you want to keep the car at fairly standard power levels, but you just want a slightly different power delivery profile, then maybe they're suitable for that sort of use case scenario. But for most people, we recommend that you go with a Garrett or a pure turbo. They are the ones that most of these BMW B48 owners are recommending that people fit to their cars. You've got the BorgWarner EFRs and the Much Boost also offer a hybrid turbo variant. But bear in mind, your choice of turbo affects dramatically the way the power is delivered. Larger turbos tend to have more lag, but better top end response. Smaller turbos deliver a faster spool up. We're dealing with a twin scroll turbo on these B48 engines. So the design of the turbo turbo is actually designed to optimize power delivery for fairly low in the RPM range. It really does feel like a naturally aspirated engine when you drive these, and you don't get that aggressive kick in. But some drivers like that, so you might want to change out the turbo for one that delivers that sharper kick in at a certain RPM point. So power limits on the B48 engine. So a lot of people will quote about 320 to 400 horsepower as the stock limit. Now, bear in mind, there's a lot of different engines, a lot of different configurations from the factory. There's also a 1.6 engine. So I certainly can't say with any certainty that these power levels are particularly safe or particularly risky. It really does depend on your engine. So that's why I'm going to be doing some more detailed videos so we can look at the more specific power limits on each of those. But the general feedback I've had implies that the fueling system is the first thing to start topping out at those levels. You'd also need better flowing heads, a stronger crank, and better pistons, which is sort of what BMW did with 300 horsepower versions. 400 horsepower is actually a relatively easy goal to have on the B48. So internal engine mods are also carried out. So we saw that JE Pistons offered a decent set of pistons for the B48 engine. They're 82 millimeter pistons. They use a 9.5 to 1 compression ratio at the stock stroke, I should say. So if you get a balanced set of rods and pistons, pay attention as well to the wrist pins. They can often prove to be the weak spot on these higher powered builds, but that'll all go some way to improving the high RPM flexibility of this engine. And that's really where you want the power. The lining on the cylinder wall is less than 1 millimeter thick. So the idea of reboring the engine is pretty much a non-starter on these. It's a very special steel plasma coating, which provides better cooling and more strength in that area where you really need it. If you're making big power, you may well find the air sensors, the airflow meters, the map, the pressure sensors, whatever you want to call them, start to struggle. So 4 bar will give you a bit more headroom over and above the stock ones. So on the B48, the fuel system, the fuel pump is often the weak spot. So fuel pump upgrades, it was difficult to get those, but around about 2023, we saw a decent offering coming out from IPOS, IPOS. And this initial release was for the Gen 1 B48 engine and certainly helped you to make higher power gains. I've also found the FX170, FX200 from Spool, but I don't have a lot of feedback on those. So I'm not recommending things where I don't have very much feedback. So please let me know what you found works on your B48 in terms of fuel pump upgrades and where the limits are on the stock fuel system, because there seems to be a lot of debate over that. There's also been various discussions about fitting the fuel system from the N20 or the B48 TU edition, which flow better fuels. So they can be bodged into place to work on the B48. But again, I have insufficient data to work from. It's not something I've actually done myself, so I can't personally vouch for that particular upgrade. So please let me know in the comments what your experience has been with fuel upgrades, because I really want to build out a rounded picture for the more precise, detailed videos that I'm going to be dropping on the B48 in due course. So around about 300, 350 horsepower on most engines, you'll start to see some kind of fuel issues. So upgrade that fuel pump and change the ejectors and make sure you've got a headroom. So most people recommend that you overspecify the injector capacity by about 20%. So that's good for two reasons. Firstly, you'll probably be doing other mods and you'll want to eat into that 20%. But also, as the injectors and the fuel system degrades, you've got a little bit of headroom to play with. If you're delivering the exact amount of fuel that your car project needs and the fuel system degrades, you're going to be underfueling, you're going to be running lean, you're going to hit all sorts of problems. So intercooler upgrades are certainly worth thinking about on these. So depending on the car that your B48 is fitted to will determine which intercooler upgrade you go for. The front mounted intercoolers, the slightly larger size, are usually better. Most people will see about 5 to 10% more power, but technically you're not really getting more power. You're getting power for a longer period of time. So the smaller intercoolers tend to suffer from heat soak, which is where the intercooler itself starts to warm up, so it's less effective at cooling that intake charge. So rather than adding power, it's stopping you from losing power, as is often the case on these highly tuned B48 projects. The turbos are adding quite a lot of heat to the air charge that's going into the engine, so you really want to reduce that as much as possible. One of our members recommended the quartz frost intercooler as a particularly effective upgrade, but obviously your intercooler size depends on your power figures, your aims and your aspirations for your B48 project, and your budget. how much money you've got to invest. So intake and exhaust mods are often discussed on the B48, but in reality, they don't make a significant difference. You might get the turbo to spool up a little bit better if you just adjust the piping around the turbo, the intake, you fit some kind of induction kit. Don't forget to sight the cold air feed going into it, but you're not looking at substantial power gains on the B48 engine. It again will depend on the car that this is set up in, but in the main, the intakes flow quite well. If you've added a lot more power, you are going to notice a restriction, so you will need to increase the ability of the intake to deliver air to the engine. But on the exhaust side as well, you want to avoid going with a large bore size because that will slow up the flow of the exhaust. You really want the scavenging effect, the little vacuum of pulse that comes after each exhaust emission from the engine, which further empties the cylinder, allowing more air to go into it for the next charge of fuel and air that's going to be burned. The catalyst is often the area where there is most restriction in the exhaust. So fitting a sports catalyst or removing the catalyst, if it's legal to do so in your area or region, will free up the flow through the exhaust system and probably free up a little bit more top end power. But the sports cats actually work very well. So if you've got the option of a better flowing sports cat in your area, then certainly go for that. On a dyno, you won't see much difference between having a catless exhaust and having a sports cat. They really are that good, those sports catalysts. So certainly think about that again, if it's legal to do so. Another mod you can do on the B48 is the lighter flywheel. So the flywheel is a great big weight on the engine. It stores the kinetic momentum from the engine. So if that's lighter, the engine can change speed more easily. So you can accelerate better. It will decelerate more quickly. That can help with rev matching. The throttle response will be a little bit sharper. The downside is the long-term fuel economy and the drivability at set speeds requires a bit more concentration and a bit more input from the driver because the car is going to be more likely to bog down on hills and inclines. So the lighter flywheel is probably not the best mod for most people. But for those just seeking to maximize their B48 engine's output, it's certainly worth thinking about and going for. So please let me know what the common weak areas are on the B48 engine. So I will be doing a problems video for the B48, but I really need your feedback. What are the common weak spots that people need to look out for on these engines? Every engine has got those design flaws or those idiosyncrasies that it's best to understand before they start manifesting themselves as problems, because you can trap those problems before they start to escalate and become bigger problems to deal with. So thanks for watching. Please boot the like button. That really does help us to get out there. Subscribe to the channel if you haven't done so. We'd hate you to miss out on all the great B48 content we've got coming up. And I've lined this video up for you that you should find really interesting. Thanks for watching.